Good evening.
Good evening.
Welcome to the Family Forum. I'm your host, The Urban Addict, sitting in with the Dr. Johnny R.C. Tyler. Today, we would like to just welcome everybody back aboard. We all been away for a while, so, you know, as the quarters changed and things that are production as far as with the studio and the new studios and the transition, we all kind of like set back and let everything take its place.
Well, listen, certainly we want to congratulate all of you that have stayed with the CAN TV family through the years, and we are just so glad to be back on the air. It's a wonderful facility, great atmosphere, and a lot of the familiar faces are still around. And of course, though, we want to go right into the Family Forums topic. Tonight, we are co-hosting. I am your co-host tonight, Dr. J.R.C. Tyler, the president of the African American Family Association. And of course, we have the Urban Addict that is here with us. And you've become very familiar with this young man who is an advocate for the urban community, especially as it relates to the city of Chicago. Now, so some of the current themes are still existing, but we, you know, we're now faced with an apparent dilemma in the city of Chicago. We continue to have the same type of urban violence. We continue to have the same type of challenges. We live in a great city where the president of the United States of America, the most powerful man theoretically in the world, resides as far as his local home is concerned. The Reverend Jesse Lewis Jackson, also a very influential individual, have great international accomplishments. He's gone to various countries to have hostages freed, to negotiate apartheid, the ending of it in South Africa. I mean, his resume speaks for himself, and have done great deeds as it relates to the national agenda here in America, as well as the Minister Louis Farrakhan. But yet, we still find ourselves in and amongst the number one city when it comes to murders and crime and so forth. We have a mayor that many would say I have a disconnect from what's happening in our communities, and we continue to have discussion around and dialogue around issues. We want you to call in tonight if you're watching and tell us what you see as the solution. That's right. Call in. You see the number on your screen, 312-738-1060. Give us a call and tell us how you think America, and especially your fair city of Chicago, our fair city, can be made better. What is the solution? Urban Addict, we start with you.
We didn't really give them a topic, but the topic was who's justice. And when we talking about who's justice, a lot of times when we looking for justice in a situation, we are referring to justice for that one incident that has taken place or whatever has brought us to that situation to talk about it. But I want to bring y'all attention to the differences about who's justice and who's being justified. Like, say, for instance, in the Rosenblog in October 9, 2012, when they was talking about Jerry Sandusky, they said that the crimes that he committed, they were heinous, and the child abuse, and they talked about it. But then when it came to Hastert,
yeah.
Dennis Hastert, there was no report on that, and Jerry Sandusky got 30 to 60 years, and he was a figurehead, and he also dealt with sports. And here it is, Hastert was a figurehead, and he also dealt with sports. But here it is, he gets 15 months, and Jerry Sandusky gets 30 to 60 years. So we talking about who's justice, who's getting justified in this situation.
Well, so we want this, so we have a caller, and you don't have to talk about Hastert or Sandusky. It's a perspective that the Urban Addict have put out. The question of justice and who actually receives justice. And let's define justice. Justice is getting what you deserve. So are individuals in America getting justice? And if so, who are they? That's just a question. But caller, go ahead. You're welcome to the Family Forum.
Good evening and welcome back, gentlemen. Part of the problem, as I see it, I've been saying this on other shows, that when people protest, when you look at Dr. King, and when you look at the person, the frame who really came up with nonviolent, Mahatma Gandhi, and when you protest, you got to be willing to make certain types of sacrifices. You got to be willing to be arrested. You got to be willing a lot of times to take up certain people's resources. Imagine what would happen if half the people in Chicago fill the jail. Imagine if we protest when we go downtown the Loop, where we have an impact on business in terms of the traffic, where they can't conduct no type of commerce, and we start hitting them in the pocket. But like I said, when it comes to real education, look at our school. They water things down so you can't get a real education in terms of how to deal with certain things. And like I said before, what's the use of going through this protesting when you're not willing to get arrested and when you have to call the system to use up a lot of resources?
So are you suggesting protesting? It sounds like initially you started out with the marching and the protesting, but it appears, and you know, correct me, that you summarized by saying what's the use in protesting. So are you an advocate of
King,
protesting?
When Dr. King protests, didn't a lot of times he got arrested, and a lot of people got locked up along with him, and he filled the jails, and it had a big impact on to that local on in terms of their resources they had to spend.
Okay, all right. Let me say something. I want to say something. I'm not in alliance with nobody. I'm not trying to sugarcoat nothing. Or
no, I ain't talking about you. I just saying.
I was leading up to a point. I'm just saying. My thing is, you know, I agree and I disagree with the protesting and all of that. But first thing I want to say, you know, Dr. King, they did their thing. You know what I'm saying? And a lot of times we always reverting back to like what Dr. King them did. And we not, it's what we doing now. You know, we can't go back and live their days. What they did is they opened the door for us, you know. So the door is open for us to do what we got to do now. We can't keep going back on what they done or how they done it. You know what I'm saying? They set a format. They done it. We salute them. More power to them. The Harriet Tubmans, the everybody, man. We got love for them. But right now, these are different times, man. Even the kids, we are in perilous times, man. With how kids respond to adults and, you know, just how police respond to the law. You know, the law is, it says on the side of police cars to serve and protect. But, you know, who getting served and who getting protected, you know? So my thing is, we are on a point to where now, you know, I heard what you saying when you saying, if you're not willing to get your hands dirty, you know, or go to jail, then you saying, man, protesting is not working. But let's get something straight. Protesting, it comes in different categories. So you may have your walkers, but they not violent. You know what I'm saying? You may have your people that get violent. You know what I'm saying? It's different type of people in different categories. So we don't want to tell nobody, don't protest, because then we sit them down. Everybody is useful and everybody can be used.
So thank you. Thank you so much. Next caller, welcome to the Family Forum.
Yes, and to the host. Listen, you brought up a good part. You started it talking about Hassett and whatchacallit. Look where we give you another justification is really truly something. Look what they did to our governor, ex-governor. They gave him 100 million years and turned around give Jesse Jackson Jr. just a little time, and then he got a chance to choose what prison he went to.
Yeah.
Then he said got a chance to change to see who's going to go first, him or his wife?
Colin,
now,
which governor,
the heck do you see this as?
Which governor, Blagojevich? Which governor received 100 million years?
How you pronounce the name?
Well, we had two governors that went to jail.
We had one
recently.
Two, actually.
Just recently.
Hold on. With the one with the horse trading, Blagojevich.
Blagojevich.
How you pronounce his name. And he gets 100 million years. Jesse Jackson Jr. just get a few months and then pick the system where court what prison he's going to serve at. Then he say, well, let me go first and my wife go second. I just don't understand. Now, that's justification. You know what? Let me tell you, the best thing, what is good for the gander supposed to be good for the goose. So if you're going to do one, treat one as just as well as you're going to treat everyone else. And it's so good to see you back again, man. I hope you do get a chance to do more shows. Thanks for taking the call.
All right. You're welcome.
So I want to come back to the previous caller. Because we're not suggesting that once again, we're asking for solutions to some of the challenges. What strategies? What do we see? And the first caller proposed a strategy. Now, I do agree that we do not, we should not live as a arrested development people, arrested development individuals that are stuck at a certain stage. And so the African-American community, the black men in America have gone through certain stages. The difference in marching today, and I can say that I lived it, I was there in the 60s, that those individuals that led us, that was a strategy, meaning that was an end in mind. They started with an end in mind. It wasn't just a march to get attention, but it was that was an agenda. And it was the economic agenda as well as a social agenda and a human rights agenda. And so the strategy was there. We always say Dr. King, but Dr. King didn't fill jails. It took young men and women of that day, college students alike, the elderly, they helped fill those jails. It wasn't black people only that filled those jails. There were whites, Unitarian ministers, there were Catholic priests, there were Jewish rabbis and other leaders. There were also mixed in terms of socioeconomic status. There were those who were the common man from the community, as well as those who were more affluent, such as James Baldwin, who was a prolific writer, such as Sidney Poitier, who was an actor, such as the entertainers of the day, Sammy Davis. So I can go on and on. So it was a network. It wasn't, and we salute the Black Lives Matter organization, but it wasn't an isolated movement that seemed not to get participation from the whole mass, everyone who had an interest in the African-American community to see us do, to see us excel and to receive the justice that we deserve, which is getting, justice is always getting what you deserve. Mercy is getting what you don't deserve.
Yeah, but
So let me just say this. So to your point, marching is good, but not what's happening now. And unfortunately, many individuals are marching. They get the attention of the powers that be. They sit in a room. They come up with whatever is going to, and I'm not charging this to Black Lives Matter. I mentioned that the organization, but now I'm being very general, that there are those who do march. They get the attention of the powers that be. They sit in a room. They negotiate. What is it going to take you from marching downtown or from protesting City Hall? And once that's settled, the individuals go back to their communities and the problem persists. So until we have individuals like Asa Philip Randolph, who was given a black check, was given a blank check not to organize the sleeping car porters, and he refused it. He said, no, I won't. This is bigger than me. Until we receive someone with the integrity of a Dr. King, who they had all type supposedly of damaging information that they could have embarrassed him publicly and said, if you don't stop, we're going to make this public. Dr. King said, you do what you have to do. But this is bigger than me. Until we have those individuals that are beyond self-interest in terms of personal gain, and their self-interest becomes the true good of the community, just a perspective, we'll continue to receive what we've been getting. Urban Addicts.
So you're saying basically that what we need is we need people that's willing to take the necessary sacrifices, and in the points of not being able to be bought as one.
What we need is a complete picture. We need we need integrity. We need a complete picture, and we need the different dynamics of what it will take for us to be successful. One thing that people often do not recognize: those individuals that sat in were not just a community that got upset one day and showed up in a downtown community, whether it was Selma, Birmingham, or Chicago. They were organized individuals, and they had gone through organization classes. They were organizers. They had sat in. They actually sat in rooms. They actually were spat on by their peers. They had food that was in plates taken and pressed in their faces, so that they were trained to be vigilant when they face the real thing.
Right.
So it was organized. And so what we have now oftentimes is a knee-jerk reaction. And your knee-jerk is only going to stay out or stay extended as long as it's feeling the brunt of the instrument that hit the knee. And so once the pain goes away, I mean, just look at Ferguson, Missouri. Now, there are some changes that are happening there. And these are some great changes. But it wasn't just a knee jerk. These individuals had been fighting for this all along. It was the shooting a couple of years ago that caused the attention of the nation and the world to look at that and say, we've got to do something. And that was what happened then. Individuals started to look at what was happening. They saw German shepherds biting young schoolgirls and older women, and they saw men being hit with billy clubs, and they said, wait, this is America, the moral standard of society, and they want us to be like them?
Right.
So America was embarrassed. But right now, you hear about what's happening with Hillary Clinton. You hear what's happening. We hear more about Donald Trump than we hear then we're hearing about the murders that are appearing in our own backyards. We get upset when a white man or a police officer shoots an unarmed individual. But where is the same content or contempt when our communities are receiving the same type of violence from one another? We just seem to accept it as though it is commonplace, and I think that's a tragedy also.
All right, well, we're going to take a quick second and listen to this caller. Caller, go ahead.
Yes, and this is addressed to the urban addict. I remember last time you brought up a subject, and I really thought about that. Do we need to wait for a black leader to lead us anywhere? You said that last year, and it made me think a little while. So what we supposed to do, sit on a step and wait for our black leader to lead us? And he was talking about back in the 60s. Well, this is 2016. It's different from then to now.
So what are you doing, though? But what are you
doing? Probably talking to the urban addict.
No, it doesn't matter who you're speaking to.
I'm trying to talk to him.
It's a legitimate question. What are you doing?
Just talk to the urban addict.
Let me ask you that.
So when this caller calls back, we don't want to receive his calls again because obviously he's not intelligent enough to respond. This is a conversation. And so it's a conversation with co-hosts. And if you can't stand the heat, stay out of the kitchen. This is the kitchen here. And if you're not ready for some answers and personal accountability, just stay home and twiddle your thumbs.
First caller, what is your name, caller? The caller's gone.
Thank you.
Okay,
I
would like to just say I want to answer the caller's question because
right.
it's a legitimate question, and I make.
Well, he didn't ask the question.
No,
he actually just made a
point,
a statement that was
relevant, and we don't want to just dismiss it because you know it's not off course. It's actually on course. So what I was saying
it's
was
perspective that I don't think it's off course.
Yeah, we don't want to keep living in Dr. King days. You know what I'm saying? We want to learn from what he's done and we want to move forward. Like reality is now.
So once again, let's just slow up so we can move forward. We're talking in circles. The question is that's legitimate is the one that we posed. What's the answer?
Right.
Not whether this question or this situation is better than the other.
Right.
My dialogue was to put in perspective. We had a first caller who called in about marching and why it isn't effective today.
Right.
So I gave a perspective. The other gentleman probably doesn't have the history to appreciate that. But just putting that in perspective.
I understand it.
This is today's generation.
Right.
But the question that we're asking you to call in with is not whether you agree with what we're saying. We're asking, what are you doing, and what is the answer?
So basically, what we're doing is we're asking y'all for a solution from your perspective on what you think that could be done, and what is your solution. And what, in my point of view, is you know one thing we got to get set in stone is a lot of things is not being taught in school no more. You know, if you go look at the Black History Month, Go see what they teaching in Black History Month. Dr. King had a dream. Then they talking about Obama and them. It's like a whole bunch of people get skipped and turned over. So, you know, Black History Month is not the same, and a lot of things not the same. But let's deal with a fact that's happening today. The youth.
Father, we'll be right with you. We know that you are there. We will be right with you.
The fact that's happening today, the youth has no understanding, of what our Black leaders have been through. And Black people do not get it mistaken. We are a power to be reckoned with. We are where we are because it was by design, but we can definitely change the blueprints. Carla, go ahead.
Carla, you're on the air. Go ahead.
Hi, my name is Carlene, and I was calling to make a comment about what I'm doing in the community.
Great.
I think the most important thing is to build relationships with the youth and not be afraid to approach them. Especially when you're seeing them doing things that you think is unbecoming. So I wanted to ask questions of what are some of the things that you all foresee as far as Black male, the best way to approach them?
Well, to approach a Black male, first of all, you talking...
Thank you so much.
Thank you for your question.
But don't go because you might have a follow-up.
To approach a Black male, you gotta talk about what element or like what atmosphere you're in, because there are different types of ways to approach a male, you know, a suit and tie male, a pants sagging male, you know, you gotta be more clear on what type of male you're talking about.
I'm talking about youth, like, give me an example. If I'm at a track meet, if I'm at a store and I see a group of young men cursing, they could even be a group of young girls, but when I say young, I'm talking about teenage, almost young adult.
I think the best way is not to correct them. When you're trying to approach a youth and Black youth, I think the best way is to approach them is with, you know, a question, you know, and not to approach them trying to correct them on what they're doing wrong. You know, constructive criticism is for those who accept it. So when you're trying to guide somebody and tell them, like, hey, you cursing, you doing this shit, it's not that way. It's like, hey, how y'all doing today? Those are some powerful words you use, you know. You know, and then you can go from there with questions, but you're not trying to correct them, because the moment you go to try to correct our youth today, everything, you get blocked out as adult, you push to the side, like, then you start getting disrespected and other things. We don't have that much time, Carla.
Yeah, do you have a follow-up? Because we do have one other caller. If it's not a repeat caller, we're going to take it. If it's a repeat caller, we can... stay here. So
the only follow-up that I have is more so I just think that if we come out of not just necessarily churches, but if we create peace circles, and if we create socialize, like teaching the kids how to socialize one to another and show them how to respect one to another, a lot of the things that we will see will cease, and we really have to work on it on the elementary stage.
Yes.
So that it won't repeat in the go forth in the high school.
Thank you.
I just want to tell you all I appreciate y'all, and I'm enjoying your show.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Final caller, you please make it quick. You have about 30 seconds just to give us a solution, and then we have to wrap up. Caller, you're on the air.
I think that caller is gone.
Oh, okay. So she actually, Carlene, I think, actually you all came back full circle, because she started and said that you have to build relationships.
Correct.
And so your approach to the young people is an introduction. That's a relationship.
That's a relationship.
Because you have affirmed them, for even though you know that the behavior can become detrimental to them.
Right.
You didn't approach condemning right away.
Right.
So that's great. But would you also consider that the context, sometimes it depends on the group, the setting. She mentioned the track meet. Perhaps these are some individuals that may have some discipline already.
So. Right, and they already organized, and they already under, if you want, you had a track meet or something like that, there's already some organization going on.
Yeah.
So that's kind of an easy approach. But for those that are not relegated to organization, then them type of people, you want to introduce yourself. You don't want to pose a threat, and then you want to be more kind-hearted to, like, let them speak. I know we running out of time. Before we close, I want to let the Dr. Tyler speak real quick.
Actually, you know, my sentiment is with the viewers that recognize that it's young men like yourself,
thank you,
the urban addict, that's going to have to be effective in changing the generation. But don't get so stuck on where you are now without knowing where the past is. One thing that makes the Jewish community so powerful is that they always remember their past. Thank you for tuning in tonight. As you get the information, go out and do something with it. God bless and good night.